I'm really excited to be here with all of you so that we can talk about this very important topic. So I really don't like to talk about the problems anymore pertaining to this issue without also discussing the solutions, because I think we have gotten into a practice of just delineating the problems, researching the problems. We are aware of what they are. But then what are our potential solutions? So I hope we can go in that direction today. The unfortunate contribution of unjust factors to health disparities. What are these unjust factors? And what are the social injustice factors that we want to lay out? Now, of course, I'm not going to go into all of them because there are so many. But let's start with lack of humanity. This issue of health disparities is about humanity. And it's about where we are lacking and what we are not doing to make sure that individuals are cared for in the way that they need to be in terms of medicine and in terms of healthcare in general. My background is public health, but I also have worked with, taught medical students, and et cetera. So I'm very clear about the relationship between these issues and medicine itself. What kind of society do we live in that doesn't ensure that everyone has access to good quality food? How is it that we believe that we can provide adequate care to individuals when their basic needs aren't met and one basic need is food? We all know that we are what we eat. So how can we expect people to be healthy when they don't have optimal health literacy? That's number two. So food injustice is number one. Health literacy is number two. Those are the two sample areas that I've chosen to hone in on today. Not having such is an affront to the very people who built this country, who are now largely poor in America, namely Black people and other marginalized emerging majority groups. We have to begin with socioeconomic status. There is a tendency to believe by some that this disparity that is existing in our society today is because Black people are inherently unhealthy as compared to white people, as well as other emerging majority groups. This is not the case. We are not talking about a situation where one group is inherently sicker than another group. We're talking about factors that exist in our society that create this situation. One way to really compare this is to take a look at the health status of Black people in the United States as compared to Black people on the continent of Africa. And one of the issues that we deal with in the U.S. that I'm going to confine myself to is socioeconomic status. We have to go all the way back to slavery. And some people say, oh my goodness, slavery, you're going to bring that up. That was 400 years ago. It's very relevant because post-slavery, there were many, many issues that occurred that continue to oppress Black people and continues to do so this day. So people have not been on a level playing field. So with that in mind, let me go over the term emerging majority groups. What we have come to understand is that in some places already, and in the near future, and the research varies, so I'm going to use 2050 as our number. It is expected that people of color will be the majority, not the minority in the United States of America. And in some cities in the US, this has already happened. In all of my books, I have eliminated this term minority because we might as well get prepared now, because the majority of individuals that you are going to be caring for in the United States of America at some point are going to be people of color. If that's the case, we need to start easing our way out of this term minority and getting into the understanding that people of color will in fact be the majority in the United States of America. So I wrote this book some time ago because I was teaching medical students and I taught public health, and I was also asked to teach in the Department of Osteopathic Medicine because the doctors were caring for many people of color and they weren't sure how to go about simple things like communication. understanding dietary patterns, understanding culture, and there were also language barriers in terms of linguistic proficiency. So I taught this course for some time, and I found that there was such a need for this that I started my consulting firm to give talks outside of the academy. It was so much that needed to be done and so much work that I actually decided to write a book because there was so much to talk about and so much to do. So that was the start of my books on this subject matter, Cultural Competency for the Health Professional. In this book, I do discuss health literacy, which is what I want to talk about right now. What do we mean when I say health literacy? Unequal educational attainment and lower social economic status impacts health literacy, which is the ability to obtain, process, and understand information and services needed to make appropriate decisions. So when I was a student in public health, one of my courses, I attended Yale University, and at that time it was the School of Medicine, and the Department of Public Health was within the School of Medicine. One of the courses that I had to take for a full semester was medical terminology. And the reason that I had to take that course is because medical language is coded. And a lot of our language is coded in the way that we communicate with each other. But when it comes to medicine and healthcare, we use a lot of terminology that individuals do not understand. They have no idea what you're saying in some cases. Maybe it's because of language proficiency, which falls under cultural competency, because we have many people, especially in Miami, who are from other cultures and whose primary language is not English. But in addition to that, we have people who were born and raised in the United States of America who, because of unequal educational attainment, may not understand what you are saying to them in terms of information that you provide to them regarding their health. And this may be on a written basis, or this might be information that you're imparting verbally. And now that we are in this scenario where we're doing things technologically, it becomes even more complicated. In general, we have to be considerate of imparting information to individuals and how we're doing it. So health literacy plays a big part in helping individuals to understand the information that you're providing to them, the medical care that you're offering to them, the post care that they have to handle for themselves, their medication that they have to take, their diet and how it relates to their health care, and etc. So it's very, very comprehensive. And I think that every physician must be mindful of this as you're dealing with your patients. It's not just about culture, but it's also about literacy levels and what an individual is capable of understanding. The next item bringing us into food is the correlation between obesity and low wages. What I'm talking about is socioeconomic status. And now I'm moving into food injustice. A UC Davis study conducted by Paul Lay resulted in the findings that the correlation between obesity and lower level wages is strong. Furthermore, public health scientists have identified several potential reasons why lower wages could support the tendency for obesity. Poorer people tend to live in less safe neighborhoods with a reduced access to parks and other low-cost means to activity. Healthy, lower-cost foods also tend to be more expensive and less available in poorer communities. So why food as a social injustice? Why have I chosen this? Because as I said earlier, food is a necessity for human survival and development. Quality and nutritional value of food matters to attain and maintain good health. The fact that we have to even discuss this as an unjust factor is so base and so important that it's imperative to impart this to medical doctors so that we can understand that patients oftentimes are not aware or not able to access what they need to be healthy. And that's a very serious problem. Furthermore, globalization pushes for cheaper and more abundant resources to meet increasing demands, but some communities are paying a huge price for corrupted corporate interests. So oftentimes when you're talking about social injustice, you have to correlate that with money, you have to correlate that with politics, you have to correlate it with other factors that don't appear to be so obvious. So with food, we can kind of break that down, which is why I chose it. So let's start with spatial and economic factors. In lower income communities, there's something that exists, and it's called food mirages. And another area of concern are food deserts. So what's the difference between the two? A food mirage is when supermarkets are built in low-income neighborhoods, but the people cannot afford the food. So that's really problematic and why it's called a mirage, because you have a grocery store right there in the community and you want to eat healthy, but you can't afford it. The second is the food desert, which is when supermarkets build outside of poor communities. So individuals cannot get to them due to lack of transportation and limited economic resources. So in terms of medical and healthcare, we often talk about access to care and lack of access to care. And there's a monetary basis to that. Maybe people don't have healthcare and they can't afford it. But sometimes people have healthcare, but they can't access it because they don't have something as basic as transportation. So when it comes to food, we find this to be a very concrete example of how that can play out. So let's talk about food deserts for a moment. What is available in food deserts? That's where we have a real problem. If we go into a lower income community, and we don't have to do a big research study to do this or anything, you can literally get on your feet or get in your car, drive to a lower income community and observe this with your own eyes. No need to read extensive papers and all of that. What we have in lower income communities are small community grocery stores. So these small community grocery stores are convenient because most people can walk to them, but they're limited in inventory. The prices are higher than in the supermarkets, and they're is limited access to healthy food within these stores. So interestingly, during the pandemic, initially when it started, I'm gonna use a very basic example. There was a limitation on toilet paper and people were very upset about this. It made news headlines and so on and so forth. But if you were to go into one of these small community grocery stores, toilet paper and other items were there abundantly. Why? Because there was no hoarding. Because when you have low income, you don't hoard because the money isn't available to do so. So you literally at that point had people coming outside of their communities and going into these small community grocery stores to get the items that weren't available in the big stores. So that was very unfortunate, but what you would find in that case is that simple items like that are more costly in these stores, which is sad. And it also contributes to the lack of availability, even though the items are there. The other thing that you find that's plentiful in food deserts would be fast food restaurants. Why? Because they offer cheap, easily accessible food. Individuals with limited income flock to them to feed themselves and their families. Nutritional value is questionable at best and problematic at worst. So here we have individuals that we are touting that we want to help and that we want to be healthy, but one of their primary food sources is fast food, not because they want to eat it necessarily, and there is some of that, but it is because it is so much more affordable to feed a family in this society with fast food than it is to feed your family with healthy produce and unprocessed items that are much more costly. Additionally, in low-income communities, we find alcohol and cigarettes abundantly. Why? Because it's easily accessible in low-income communities. So you find liquor stores abundantly. You find cigarettes in those stores. You find cigarettes in the small community grocery stores and so forth, readily available to people. And they are available in excess in low-income communities. You find cigarettes in those stores. You find cigarettes in the small community grocery stores and so forth, readily available to people. And they are available in excess in low-income communities. So this situation of food deserts and food mirages is very, very critical. Now, there are so many unjust factors that we won't be able to cover because we're using these examples. But I did want to point out in my book, Health, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion, which was mentioned in my introduction, I cover literally almost, I should say, you can never say all, but I cover many, many unjust factors, including mass incarceration, the school-to-prison pipeline, all kinds of factors that are contributing to health disparities. So let's go back to the profit scenario in terms of food injustice. One of the issues that exists with the food that people can access is antibiotics and hormones are fed and given to livestock and then consumed by humans. So I'm sure you all are familiar with antibiotics, you use them in your practice, but overuse of antibiotics in terms of the ingestion of food is a serious problem because most people don't even realize that it's happening. Undocumented immigrant workers comprise much of the employee base for meatpacking plants, enduring high risks, and they get little financial gain. Consumers are not told crucial information about the products they are buying. Companies seek to keep their methods private and quiet. So many people are unable to discern information that relates to their health and making informed decisions due to health literacy issues. So you see how these things tie together. So if you want to eat grass-fed meat, if you want in terms of beef, if you want to eat all kinds of meat that does not have antibiotics and does not have hormones and all of those things, you have to go to stores that actually offer that. And when you go to these stores that actually offer that, it's more expensive. So it literally puts people out of the possibility of enjoying food that doesn't have these additives that are harmful to their bodies in them. So that is a very real issue. How many times do you have the opportunity to talk to your patients about the food that they're ingesting and how it may be impacting their health? And that kind of dialogue can lead you into an understanding of their socioeconomic status and other factors that might be contributing to their health status. These factors cannot be left out of the picture in caring for a patient. So I want to move in after going through those two examples to talk about some solutions. So what are some solutions for food injustice as an example for low-income communities? The first is the growing of produce in low-income neighborhoods. So you see some neighborhoods doing that today. Some neighborhoods are growing community gardens and et cetera, and trying to make sure they have access to basic things like fresh fruits and vegetables. We will just take it for granted that we can have this produce in our lives. Availability of organic produce, for example, non-GMO items and hormone and antibiotic free meat and poultry. Various vendors that accept EBT and products at lower costs. Government subsidies would be useful for those scenarios. So a lot of people who are functioning on a low socioeconomic basis are receiving food subsidy funds from the United States government. If that's the case, then entities that provide food have to accept those funds. And so that is accepting of EBT. The placement of supermarkets in low-income communities with affordable prices and healthy food items, de-emphasizing processed food. So what do we have to do overall to help individuals in terms of literacy levels, in terms of food injustice, and in terms of other unjust factors? I have a cycle that I'm going to go over with you right now. And this cycle is depicted in my book. And I created it so that people can kind of have an understanding of what this vicious cycle looks like and some of the other factors. The first, lower socioeconomic status and marginalized communities. Who are those marginalized communities? Emerging majority people who are experiencing health disparity, including what we went over, food deserts and mirages, poor quality education, health illiteracy, high unemployment, and beyond. The next are topics that I didn't go over for the sake of time, but they're critical. The school to prison pipeline, putting young people in marginalized communities into prisons, the drug war, immigrant detainment, and mass incarceration of emerging majority people. The next category is the insidious behavior around this situation of unjust factors that is practiced in our society. The first one being prison profiteers, medical prison profiteers, and corporate prison profiteers. These are individuals who are benefiting from individuals being in prison by offering medical services that are not adequate to these individuals, and also by charging them inordinate fees for simple things like making telephone calls or receiving telephone calls and buying some of their basic needs while they're in prison. So prison medicine is another issue that I think is a very interesting one to explore, covered thoroughly in my textbook. Next, we have private, federal, and state level issues within these prisons. Prisons are very important because we're dealing with them at a federal level, at a state level, and we're dealing with them at a private level because we have lots of private prisons in the United States of America. From prison, we have prisoner release. Once prisoners serve their time, they are, of course, released. And this release is followed by recidivism due to economic, emotional, spiritual, and overall deprivation. So we have all of those unjust factors taking place in this cycle, and then we are back to lower socioeconomic status and marginalized communities. We have a tendency to talk only about problems and not solutions, and that really needs to stop. There's some practical solutions, but there are also ideal solutions. So I'm going to touch upon the ideal solutions right now. And I have entitled this an ideal solution towards health equity. What will it take to fix all of this? The first is economic justice and overall social justice. And that includes food justice and cultural and linguistic competency in all areas. Cultural and linguistic competency is a skill set. If physicians and other healthcare practitioners are not capable of utilizing that skill set of communicating with their patients optimally on a cultural and linguistic basis, they're missing a very significant skill that goes hand in hand with their medical acuity. So those things must come together in a society that is so diverse. Also, quality education, employment opportunities, universal health care, and health literacy for all. Now, I understand that universal health care is a hot button political issue. And so at this point right here, I am simply suggesting that it be looked at, that it be explored. What does it mean? What is this discussion about universal healthcare, public option, Obamacare, all of those things? It is imperative that we as healthcare practitioners, public health practitioners, medical practitioners, that we are deeply involved in this dialogue so that we can decide what is best to reduce health disparities. So I leave that open for discussion. And lastly is the elimination of unjust escalated negative factors. And one is the drug war. And this is one of the reasons, not the main reason, but one of the reasons for the school to prison pipeline, prison profiteering, and mass incarceration. If we look at all of these items and we consider how we can develop solutions around them, what we will be striving for is what we must strive for. And that is to no longer have health disparities in our society, but to move us all toward health equity for all. Thank you so much for listening.